further backwards. So this is lecture 02. So I just start by recalling what I did. Well, we started with a unital. Associative, was that correct? Yes. K-algebra. And we had the R, right A modules. So M, we put this equal to the direct sum of MI, I is equal to 1 to R. The summation, and MI is a right A module. So it is in mod, and the A on the right side is a right A module. Mm-hmm. Then we defined the deformation functor, def M, from a category L hat into sets. And the point with that functor was that if spec, I think I called it L, but why not call it R? If spec R is moduli, then of right A modules, then the deformation functor, def M, and I put an R up here. No, an A up here, because M is a family of A modules. Just to tell what the ring is. This is then isomorphic to the morphisms from R, localized in M, and completed. So this is suddenly it's an object of L hat, and then bar. That is the same as to saying that Rm hat pro represent def M as R modules. Okay? So the point with all these lectures is to find or at least approximate the local ring on the moduli space. That's really ambitious. I will then give parameters to classify the different A modules. And furthermore, I will give all the relations possible between those objects. So when do we use this? So let's give us an example. I have to say it. And that is because De Monet started the story. So I just had to change my lecture. So let Q be a quiver. Q naught, that's the nodes. Q1, that's the arrows. With source, S, and tails, T. Wasn't that was the way you write it, isn't it? Yes. Then, De Monet defined M to be a representation. M, a representation. And De Monet are going to study these representations of quivers. But that's not very far from what I'm doing, because I can define the quiver algebra. And what is the quiver algebra? It's just a free algebra over all the arrows, Q1. is not really free, because if I compose two arrows that can be composed, it goes to zero. If not, it's the formal composition of arrows. Then suddenly, these representations, they are KQ modules. So then the representations of the quiver, this category is equivalent with the category of mod K over KQ1. So when I compute a pro-representing hull of this one, call it R, M, and this as a, this time as a KQ1 module, then I get, in fact, the local moduli of the set of all representations. So I say that I tell you everything, at least locally, around some representation. So that had to be said. So this is a very nice example that I have a unit of non-commutative associative algebra, and the representation is a representation of a quiver. R is, I approximate this ring, which is the pro-representing hull, in fact. But I haven't defined this yet, so I just called it like that. So, having said this, because this is the last lecture for today, so we can take a little stand-up show, can't we? So, observation. This school is about cluster algebras. This says that this school we are really interested in are quivers. Q, quivers. And they're like. Okay. And from this, we have the cluster algebras. And that's the main object of this school. So then we started with Trinka. They missed some vocals there for me. But is that the correct way to say it? Trinka? It's okay. He had some physical objects he wanted to study. Some physical objects. I know nothing about physics, but I saw that he had some physical objects. He made that objects correspond to points in strata in moduli spaces of Grassmannians. So this physical object, in fact, lives in strata of Grassmannians. And then, he said nothing more. He said this, that this is the point, I give you these Grassmannians, you have to find the cluster algebras in this yourself, I'm not doing the tidying here. So you have to find the cluster algebras yourself. And I will come to that. Two. Then, Mathern. Is that the correct spelling? It should be mutern, shouldn't it? Mutern. To a quiver, Q, he associates a quiver algebra, a cluster algebra, AQ. Oops, AQ. Well, I think of this as, by the way, that I represent the quiver in algebras. How do we think of a cluster? I mean, how do I represent a word, sometimes by letters? Here, we represent the quiver as an algebra. So then we study quivers by studying these algebras. If you know much about these algebras, then you know much about the clusters, the quivers. Then, and this could equally well be Nakanishi. It was just a question of who of them was first. I mean, the one who defined the cluster algebras. The rest of the work of Matern has been to study these particular algebras. So now comes Hanani. He left, now I can say what I want. Hope he hasn't installed Java on his computer, because then he can't watch it. Hanani, he also, as Trinka, had a physical object. And to that physical object, he associates a quiver. Well, you're back. Pity. And then, Hanani, given his physical object, associates a quiver, and he studied a physical object by representations. Study the object by the quiver, by representations. And in difference from the other ones, Hanani doesn't say where he is representing them. He just says that it is in a moduli space. And he can't use the time to tell about these Lie structures and all this will in fact give these moduli spaces, because that is impossible in so short time. So he just says that they are given by representations in a moduli space. I don't say that this is everything they've done. This is what I observed as something they have done. Then, three. Then comes Demonet. And he represents the quiver by linear algebra, not by giving an algebra, but giving a linear algebra. Q is represented by linear algebra. So he studied these linear algebras, the resulting algebras, to squeeze the juice from a quiver. And there shouldn't be much juice in the quiver, but there is. Okay. One, two, then it's better. Three, four. Then five, in fact. It's counting that is the problem. Kulkarni. She goes the other way around. In fact, she finds the algebras occurring as cluster algebras. So, this in fact is that she studies algebras by finding their corresponding quiver when they exist. By seeds, as Nakanishi called them. She finds the seeds, in fact. Also, she answers the first question. She is the one that tells us what these physical objects in the strata of Grassmannians had to do with cluster algebras. Brilliant. These sort things out. And then Nakanishi, he tastes the juice of the quiver algebras because you compute the properties of the cluster algebras. So a thorough study of the cluster algebras. So this means that what I'm doing, I'm concentrating on the representations in Lie algebras. But as I told you in the beginning, this was just a choice. I could use any abelian small category. So I could use algebras instead. So this says that I'm really trying to unify all these models. And that's not my idea, honestly. I'm just a worker, a labor man. I've learned the technique from my supervisor, and I've done this all the time. So I just observe, and I think that if the taxi driver home from Oslo asked me, what did you do in India? I will tell him this. That is what we did in India. And also, one of the great master students here, he have even tried to represent these quivers in knots, to do knot theory out of this. So all in all, these cluster algebras, they pop up nearly everywhere. Okay, so now I continue lecture one. So, okay, I can write up the definition of the deformation functor maybe. Maybe that's clever, a smart thing to do. Deformations of M to an element S in L, in AR, in fact. No, it is non-commutative. That is the set of S tensor KA modules. MS such that MS is S flat, that is the same as flat over S, and such that K to the R tensor over K tensor over S by MS is isomorphic to M as an A to the R module then. And the equivalence, just drop it. You will see it when you need it. So the first observation is that flatness replaces continuity in the differential geometric setting. And it's very easy. I put this up as a lemma. So let S be an object of AR, that was an R-pointed Artinian K algebra. Then MS is S flat, and this is an S tensor K A module, and it is S flat if and only if MS is isomorphic to, not as S tensor K A module, but as S module with S tensor over K to the art M. Well, how to prove that? How to prove flatness? That's generally a very hard question. But, I mean, if it is on this form, then it is in principle free over M. And free is flat, so it's okay. On the other hand, assume that it is flat. Then take a resolution as A tensor K S module and tensor over S with K. Anything is flat, or K is flat over anything. So then we end up there. But it is a tricky proof. So I could replace flatness with this one in the definition, but it is actually equivalent. So then we use flatness because it replaces continuity. So this lemma, this says that MS, this scary deformation, in fact, as S module, it looks like Sij tensor over K MJ. In fact, that's how I do this one. S is a matrix, and I multiply it with the m's on the diagonal. Then I get this Sij tensor MJ. No, it should not. Well, we have a matrix S11, S1R, SR1, SRR, times, you can use it diagonal if you want to, M1, MR. And then you multiply it. That's how this tensor product is. So it is directly over there. You have to check that, of course. But that's the property of the tensor product of right modules. No. It is that simple. Yes? Flat over S. Yes. Yes. So that's our criteria. So a deformation up here is something that looks like this, but it should also be an A module. Here it is a natural S module from the left, and it is this module, but the A module structure, that's hidden. That's the one we have to construct, in fact. So then I have a little problem, because de Monet reminded me that most of the students are unknown to cohomology and homology. Most of you. Do you know about homology and cohomology? Hochschild cohomology, for instance? More? No? Okay. I will need Hochschild cohomology, so I have to define that one. So, I define the cycles CHI of an K algebra A and then A by module M is equal to, let me write up the definition and I will tell you what the by module is. This is the homomorphisms, hom K from A tensorized with itself I times into M. So M by module, that means that it is both the left and the right A module. Both the left and the right A module. I was afraid I was losing my ears, but it was a microphone. Yes? In fact, you have to do that because this is contravariant in the second variable. After a while, when we are using or particular bimodule. Yes. But if this. Yes, but it can be an. This, if this isn't. This is in fact an AA bimodule. Exactly. But it can, so it both a left and a right module, so that it is associative. But if the world is not very great, then we could also define an AA opposite bimodule, of course. If you have a left A module, then it will be a right A opposite module. So if you are working with left modules, then I need to take an AA opposite bi module. And then I need to use this one in this one. But as long as I'm working with only right modules, this works well and good. But that's a good comment. Okay, so. Let's say that the only point is that we have multiplications from the left and from the right, and such that it is associative, of course. Then this is, for those who are scared about the tensor sign, just remember that this is the same as the K multilinear mappings. So I need a mapping from CHIAM. That is DI going into CHAI plus 1. Yes? Of M. So how is this given? So take phi in here. I don't know if I remember it, but let us try. That is a morphism from A tensor to the I into M. And I have to define a morphism in here. Psi going from A tensor in I plus 1 into M. So I define psi of A1 up to A I plus 1 to be equal to A1 times psi of A2 up to A I plus 1. Because now there are I pieces, so it works. Plus, I mean, these are details that really doesn't matter, but. Okay, then you learn Hochschildkommen, so okay. The sum from N is equal to, has to be 2 then, up to I, minus 1 to the nth, psi of A2 dot dot dot, and we take AN minus 1 times AN dot 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 up to I plus 1, and then plus the last one, minus 1 up to I plus 1. and then psi of A2 AI times AI plus 1. Yes? Excuse me. I mean phi, of course. Because it was psi I should define by phi. Yes. Okay. So this might be wrong, but it is in any textbook or on Wikipedia. Okay, that's good. So check that D I together with D I plus 1 in the correct composition series is equal to 0. Then we define the ith Hochschild cohomology of AM equal to kernel of DI divided out by the image of DI plus 1. Oh, sorry, of course. Very good. AI plus AI times AI plus 1, like this. No, it's even more correct. Close to. In fact, this is a standard way of doing it. So, this sign always pops up. Well, now we are finished with the sum, so now the last pops out. So now there are I minus. Yes, of course, you're right, this A1. I claim to have a bird's view, but it certainly was completely wrong. Here? Yes, because you combine the two middle ones. So you should have A1 there too. So it shouldn't be like this. I think that one is correct. I think that one is correct. But I mean, anyway, look it up. If you don't get that this is 0, then this is wrong. Then you have to adjust it. Anyway, we are just using the first one, the first Hochschild cohomology. So this is, let me write it, Hochschild cohomology. So, what I need, notice that if M and N are two right A modules, and A is our K-algebra, exactly as before, then HOM K, the K-linear maps, from M to N is an AA bimodule. That's a bit strange, maybe. Phi from M to N. What is the right multiplication? A times phi. What should that be given like? Well, it is given by this morphism. No, it is a right module, so I multiply from the right times A. This is A times phi. What is phi times A? Well, that is going down here, multiplying from the right by A to N. And I get this module, phi times A, both morphisms from M to M. So this says that A phi. Oh, it's, no, from the left, A times phi of some M should be equal to phi of M times A. It's a bit complicated, but this is the right module. And phi times A of M from the right, that is exactly as it should be. It is phi of M times A. So this is a pi module. This looks better. You see, we use water on the swamp in Norway. No, because it is a right module. M is a right module, not a left module. So I multiply from the right. Phi is just linear, yes? Okay. Yes, so it's home K. It's not an A module homomorphism, that's very important. So this is as linear vector spaces. Because then we have a theorem, or call it what you want to call it. The Hochschild cohomology. Ith Hochschild cohomology of Hom K M N with values in A is not a much easier explanation than the Monet came up with, but it is true. This is one A M N. It's not the usual definition, that's why I call this a theorem. But for those who don't know anything, it can be the definition of X. Usually we use some resolutions, and X is the XI. And X is the ith right derived functor of HOM. It's still true if it is commutative. Yeah, yes, it is useful also if it is commutative. Absolutely. But then it's much easier. Much easier. Yes, you can. Yes, absolutely. So this computation, as I said, it includes the commutative one. So we don't exclude the case where A is commutative. Okay. So here's a lemma, which I need for the computations. Okay, again, if M is M1 plus M2 plus MR, as before, these are right modules, then the deformations of M to this E, recall that one, this is in fact isomorphic to X1A, MI, MJ. And this is a matrix with A modules in each entry, and this is equivalent to the deformations up to E. And we recall that E was then equal to the one with just one here, K, T11, T12, up to T1R, and then just down to TR1, TRR, divided by the square of the radical. All of these TIJs, IJ squared. So, I with a K here, okay. Then these are just one of these at each point, because I know I'm just looking at the tangent space. And each element in X gives me one tangent, or one coordinate. That's a reason for thinking of the coordinates as tangents. So, if you prove that statement, or sketch the proof, then there are some possibility to follow the construction of the definition of the pro-representing hull. Okay, don't use this as an argument for replacing the boards with whiteboards. It's my fault. I'm too harsh with the chalk. Okay. So proof. So yes, okay. Then may stop a bit earlier. That's okay. I won't stress it. I will leave the stress for tomorrow morning, because that's the last lecture then. I don't have to please you. Okay. To give a deformation to give a deformation ME, to E, is to give, okay, no, to give a deformation of M, which was the sum of these MI, to give a deformation of D is to give ME in def ME. And now E stands here. It's not pretty, but it's here. Okay? That is equivalent to give an A module. No, not an A module, because now I give an A module structure. It's the same as to give an K algebra. K algebra homomorphism. Eta M from A into hom K M. Okay, it's really EIJ tensor MJ into EIJ tensor MJ. Okay, why is this so? Well, here is E, and the deformation to E has to be on the form EIJ tensor MJ. Then it is automatically flat if it is on this form. And it's obviously an E module from the left. So if I give it a K algebra homomorphism here, then this is the same as to give an A module structure. Then it is both an S and an A module structure. But because this should be isomorphic as an E module, this is in fact induced by, and I use the same name, eta M, which goes from A and into hom K. And I just have to take M and then EIJ tensor over KMJ, this matrix module. Because if I have given this one, then multiplication by S is induced, because it is free over E as S module. So, I mean, the point is that if I take A times something lying in E, and then E tensor M, then this is automatically A times 1, no, E. E goes up because it is E linear, times 1 times MA as left module. So it's enough to define this one from M and into there, and to extend it linearly to an homomorphism to EIJ. This is possible to see, I think. So, for each, if you do this in the commutative case with only one variable, it's much easier to see. But why should everything be so easy? So, let Xi ij from A and into hom K, M, I, M, J be given by, okay, be given by Xi, I, J of A should then be eta of A restricted to Tij. I mean, I have a morphism in here, and I restrict it to each Tij, being a basis element in Erj. So that is to say, so Ie, id est, eta A of some A is in fact equal to the identity times A plus the sum for 1 less than equal to I and J less than equal to R. And it has these variables Tij, and there comes an element in there, which is the multiplication from N into there, 1 plus some Tij. The identity along the diagonal, because this has a 1 on the diagonal, this is just multiplied by A, and the ones that doesn't have a 1 on the diagonal, this ends up here, by a coefficient Cij of A. So, to give a deformation is equivalent to give an A-module structure. This leads to a coefficient in front of each of these Tijs in here, so that this eta A, in fact, can be written like that. No. It's just to check it, that check that, and you can read our book if you want to, or look at the notes, but it's not, well it is, yes, it's on, there's some examples there, and I think you will not be able to understand it to the full without doing examples, in fact. So Cij, it is in the k derivation, it is a k derivation of A and hom k m I m j. And I mod it out by the inner homomorphisms. That's the adjoint, ad A. You know how to make an inner derivation. Take the Lie bracket, A bar. So really doesn't matter. Divide out by those one. And then this one is, in fact, isomorphic to x1 A, mi, mj. Conversely, given any matrix, so I can just put an arrow the other way, because given such derivations, then I can just define this eta I this way, and I can prove that this Lie algebra, this morphism will be a K-algebra homomorphism. The only check is the associativity, but that is okay, because then I get a multiple of variables and they disappear. So it will be associative. So that is why we call this the tangent space. Def M of E is called the tangent space. And that is also M. Schlesinger's definition. The deformation factor of the dual numbers is a tangent space. Of course, here we define it as a tangent space. And then this is when we discover that these are not arrows, they are tangent directions. Okay, so now this is the main thing, in fact. To understand this, so, okay, I think I can do small morphisms, then this is also done for tomorrow. Very good. So now, the idea is how to lift deformations. If I have in L, in the category L, in the category AR, if I have R surjectively onto S, and I have def M of, okay, the deformations here, how do I lift them up to def MR? Why would I like to do that? Well, you will see it is how we construct the smallest set of relations so that we can lift this up to the top. So then we force it to be the pro-representing whole. So that's the point. So we need to lift these deformations. And now both of these are in AR. So the point is that any surjection in AR can be composed in small morphisms. And what is a small morphism? Phi R to S is small. This means that the radical of I, that's the Jacobson radical, IR, times the kernel of phi is equal to zero. Then it is small. This is Nakayama's lemma, who said that if this is surjective, then the model is finitely generated. So this is the non-commutative Nakayama's lemma, absolutely, that every small morphism can be factored, can be composed in small morphisms. So just to see, if I take R, and I want to map this one into S, and I want to decompose this one, then R is equal to R divided out by IR to the nth if IRN is zero. The radical of R to the nth is equal to zero. And I assume that the radical of S to the nth is equal to zero. And I have to assume that n is bigger than m. If not, there is nothing to prove. And there's nothing to prove. So then this maps down to R over I, R in n plus 1, minus 1, And this maps down to and ends up in R divided out by I, R, and I have to go to M minus 1. Do I end there? Because then this, why not to the mth? Then this one maps directly into here. So this is the decomposition. To decompose it into small morphisms. Okay, then we have cohomology. We have the tangent lemma with the proof, which is in fact essential for the rest of the computation. And we can start by defining hulls and pro-representing objects. And this is great because this is an easy easy end to it. So we have to go back to, back to category theory. And I want to tell about Yoneda's lemma, which is quite general and rather easy, in fact. So F from a category into sets, exactly as the other days, and I assume it is covariant. That means just an ordinary functor, no fuss, no reversing of arrows, nothing. Then we have for every or for any C in this object of, make it a bit script, in C, take an object in C, then I have a isomorphism, bijection of sets, F of C is equivalent with the morphisms from. And now there are the morphisms in the meaning of natural transformation of functors from this functor of points, which we have defined, more C bar into F. This is an isomorphism, a bijection of sets. Proof? And this is really an easy proof. If you take Xi, which lies in here, then this should be sent to an equivalence of functors. So it should be sent to an equivalence of functors, Phi Xi, which goes from the morphisms C bar to F, because then it is an element in here. And this phi xi, this takes an element in here, which is a morphism from C to D, call it eta, and I should apply phi xi to this one. And this should then be an element in F of D, if I put in D here. Then I should have an element F in D. And this is F, the functor, applied by eta. F of eta is a morphism from more CD into F of D. So I take this one off Xi, because Xi is an element in F of C. And then you can check that this sets up an isomorphism. The converse, put C in both places, and then you have the identity. And let this be defined by the identity. Then you have the inverse equivalence of functors. So now we are in sets. This is a bijection of sets. But this is the set of natural equivalences, the set of equivalences of natural transformations. So yes, is it really easy, but it is abstract. It cannot be more abstract. So, but the point is that and I will postpone that to next time. If I have an element here, then I get an amorphism here of functors. If this is an isomorphism, then this object C will be called a fine moduli. And if C is the category L, then it's not phi anymore. And if it is AR hat or AR hat or L hat, then it is just a pro-representing hull. And the point that we never find the pro-representing hull, that's very special. What we can find is that this morphism is a bijection on the tangent space, and that it can be lifted uniquely or smoothly, essentially surjective. Then it is called the pro-representing hull. So then we just have to construct the pro-representing hull with the definition. So if you sleep on that definition, then the detailed computation tomorrow will be painful, but then you have seen it and nothing more. Okay, so I will stop there.
For that wonderful talk, and you can see how he has related what everybody has been talking here to this more general and more general setting, more general setup. And are there any questions?
So this will work also in any category, in fact. Oh, Bionedas lemma. Oh, of course there are. Of course there are. Yes. So this is the one I need in my AR hat categories, in the local Athenian case. Any other version fits this?
Okay, any other questions? Okay, in that case, let's thank the speaker again.